An evening of Korean drumming, mask dance, Brazilian and Asian fusion, and interactive activities. Through this gathering, we will share the collective experience of our community and recognize the connections we have with other communities of color. Be a part of a new history in the making on Saturday, November 12th at 7 p.m. at the Oakland Museum of California's James Moore Theater, 1000 Oak Street by Lake Merritt BART Station. Tickets are $15 for students and seniors, $18 general admission. Refreshments will be served. Please dress warm as part of the event will be outside. For more information, call 510-652-4964.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1:30. Stay tuned next for Making Contact.
This week on Making Contact.
Religion at its best is not ideologically predictable or loyally partisan. Millions of evangelical Christians in America don't feel represented by Jerry Falwell, Pat Robertson, and James Dobson. When someone steals your faith, sometimes you decide it's just time to take it back.
A growing movement is working to put spirituality and morality back into the left wing. Its goals are specific: unite secular and religious liberals by reclaiming faith, replace the culture of materialism with one of love and care, and challenge the religious right. On this edition, we'll hear from three prominent and controversial speakers, Rabbi Michael Lerner, evangelical preacher Jim Wallis, and cultural historian Rebecca Solnit. I'm Tina Rubio, your host this week on Making Contact, a program creating connections between people, vital ideas, and important information. This past summer in Berkeley, California, more than 1,300 people of all religious faiths came together for the first time to talk about the importance of spirituality in activism. It was the beginning of a series of similar events planned across the U.S. Mostly white and middle-aged, they call themselves the Network of Spiritual Progressives. Outspoken rabbi, author, and anti-war protester Michael Lerner is the man spearheading the network. His new book, The Left Hand of God, Taking Our Country Back from the Religious Right. Lerner spoke about a spiritual crisis in our society and why he thinks the secular left doesn't get it.
There is a spiritual crisis in this society because of the dominance of the ethos of materialism and selfishness that people learn day in and day out in the world of work. And the right articulated that and said there's a spiritual crisis. And the truth is that the right was correct about that. There really is a spiritual crisis. And they earned tremendous political credibility because they were willing to talk about the spiritual crisis in people's lives and give a name to a pain that people were actually and are actually experiencing day after day after day. Now, the terrible tragedy is that the right then analyzes that by saying the reason for this materialism and selfishness that's undermining loving relationships and families and so forth, that's because of the, and then they turned to the demeaned others of the society. In Europe, they turned and said it was the Jews. Jews are selfish. Jews are looking out for themselves. Jews are materialistic. Jews are whatever, okay? You know the line. In the United States, the demeaned, primary demeaned others have always been African Americans. And in some places, American Indians, okay, Native Americans. Increasingly today, that role is being played by gays and lesbians, right? That they are the ones, and feminists, and now liberals and secular humanists are all being put into this position. They are the ones who are introducing their own selfish agenda, the special interests, into political discourse, and that's why you are suffering in your family life. That's why you are in pain, because there is this selfishness and materialism surrounding us. People know that there is the selfishness and materialism. They give it an analysis that is distorted. Now, the irony here is that the right, meanwhile, is the primary articulator and defender of the selfishness and materialism in the world of work. Because in the world of work, They are the ones who fight against the introduction of any criteria of social responsibility. They are the ones who continually say, do not interfere with the ability of each corporation to pursue its own selfish interests without regard to the consequences to anybody else. Now, how do they get away with this? How do they get away with being, on the one hand, the force that opposes every piece of legislation that would restrict selfishness and materialism in the world of work, and on the other hand, being the articulator of the pain that people feel when the ethos of selfishness and materialism that they've learned all day in the world of work is brought home, as it inevitably is, into personal life and plays out in destructive ways? How do they get away with working both sides of the street? The answer is they get away with it because there is no other voice in town, because the liberals don't get it. They get away with it because the liberal and progressive forces don't even understand that there is a spiritual crisis, and in fact think that when people talk about a spiritual crisis, all they mean is that that those are code words for racism, sexism, and homophobia. In other words, they take the rights analysis, and because they take the rights analysis, which is racist, sexist, and homophobic, they then say that there's no real problem. It's only, but there is a real problem, even though the rights analysis of the problem is wrong. Do you get it? There is a real problem. So, what is needed is a spiritual, progressive voice that can acknowledge that there is a real spiritual crisis. In fact, insist that that crisis has to be the central issue of politics, but provides a different analysis and a different solution that talks about where it really comes from, where the spiritual crisis really comes from, and how to solve that spiritual crisis. And that's what we're talking about when we say we need to create a network of spiritual progressives, a new kind of voice in this country that can articulate a spiritual vision that is a critique of the spiritual crisis and that has some answers to it. Now, what are those answers? What is a politics around a network of spiritual progressives? What would be the content of the politics? Well, the fundamental core vision of a network of spiritual progressives is this. We need a new bottom line. A new bottom line. The current bottom line is materialism and selfishness. We need a bottom line of love and caring. Or let me put it to you another way. Today, institutions are judged efficient, rational, or productive to the extent that they maximize money and power. We are saying that the institutions should be judged efficient, rational, and productive not only to the extent that they maximize money and power, but also to the extent that they maximize love and caring, kindness and generosity, ethical, ecological sensitivity, and enhance our capacities to respond to each other and to the universe with awe, wonder, and radical amazement. That's a fundamentally, radically different vision of the world. And it's not, doesn't fit into left-right, because the left doesn't articulate this any more than the right does. This is a spiritual vision. It says we need a whole new way of judging what we think of as rational behavior, what we think of as productive, what we think of as efficient, a whole new way. And if we did this, we would see that almost every institution of this society is inefficient, irrational, unproductive. They don't tend to produce loving and caring and human beings. They don't tend to produce ethically and ecologically sensitive human beings. They don't tend to enhance our capacities to respond to the universe with awe and wonder. No, don't get me wrong. It's not that we don't have a lot of loving and caring human beings. We do. We have a lot of people who are ethically and ecologically sensitive, but we are that despite the institutions we live in, not because of them. We need to propose to the Democratic Party, to the Greens, and to all the other parties, a spiritual covenant with America that puts forward our values at the center and articulates those values for how they can be in politics. And consequently, the network of spiritual progressives on a local level should be forming caucuses inside the Democratic Party, spiritual Democrats, inside the Greens, spiritual Greens, to articulate and fight for a spiritual vision inside those parties. When I went to give a talk like this to a group of 400 Methodists in Kansas, and after there was a tremendous response, standing ovation, they so much loved what I was saying, but then they came up to me and said, "It's great, Rabbi Lerner, but it'll never work." So I said, "Well, why will it never work?" They said, Because the only people who would believe these kinds of ideas are Methodists in Kansas. So I said, well, why do you think that? Why do you think that? They said, well, we're smart people. We watch television, we read newspapers. We know what people are like on the coasts. Everybody in the, you know, we know what, they're all so into themselves and selfishness and materialism and so forth. Now, on the other hand, when we talk about this in New York or Washington or San Francisco or Los Angeles, people say to us, yeah, that's great, but middle America? And this is the key, folks. We all keep insisting that it's only us and the people in our group who want a different kind of world. But what I want to tell you is that all of us, every single person, has both voices in them. Both voices going on all the time. And to the extent that they look around and don't see anybody else out there articulating a voice of love and kindness and compassion, then they do think, yeah, this is just idealism that can never happen. And so they repress that voice in themselves and go with the more cynical voice, the voice of the right hand of God, the voice of domination and control, and think that that's the only realistic path that they can go. Consequently, the way to change this is not just to fight against media or government or corporations, is to also change ourselves to the point where we could ourselves begin to articulate what we really believe in, to go for your highest goals. That is, this movement, the power of this movement is that we will say publicly what so many people privately want but dare not say for fear that they will be ridiculed and humiliated for saying that they believe in a world of love and kindness.
That was Rabbi and author Michael Lerner speaking to the Network of Spiritual Progressives. We'll have more in a few moments. You're listening to Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information or for cassette or CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit our website at radioproject.org. Jim Wallis is an evangelical Christian, preacher, and professor. He's also the editor of Sojourners, a magazine about faith, politics, and culture. And he's also the best-selling author of God's Politics, Why the Right Gets It Wrong and the Left Doesn't Get It. Wallis has led more than 250 town meetings across the U.S., bringing together pastors and civic and business leaders to discuss politics and morality. At the first Conference of Spiritual Progressives in Berkeley, California, Wallis spoke about the many Christians who are rising up and rejecting the dogma of the religious right in favor of a more spiritually inclusive vision of society.
We've been having town meetings disguised as book signings. Across America, revivals in bookstores. And I've got some good news. I've been now to the East, the Midwest, the South, Texas, Rocky Mountains, Florida, Pacific Northwest, California, and I want to make an announcement. I think you'll find this to be good news. I am now convinced, after 49 cities, in 21 weeks, meeting face-to-face 80,000 people, listening to them, I'm convinced the monologue of the religious right is finally over and a new dialogue has just begun. Some have called it the rise of the non-religious right. That's not much of a name for a movement, but movement is what's on everybody's mind. On everyone's, they want to join something. They want to be part of something. They want to make a difference. And I want to tell you who's coming. I want to tell you the guest list and see if you might recognize yourself. First of all, a whole lot of evangelical Christians are coming. Millions of evangelical Christians in America don't feel represented by Jerry Falwell, Pat Robertson, and James Dobson. When George W. Bush went to do a commencement address at Calvin College in Grand Rapids, Michigan, a place Karl Rove chose as a very safe place for the president, an ad appeared in the Grand Rapids newspaper signed by one-third of the Calvin student body and faculty saying, "Mr. President, because of our shared Christian faith, we implore you to reconsider your priorities and your policies which favor the rich over the poor, despoil God's creation, and prosecute an unjust, illegal, and immoral war." That was in the red part of the blue state of Michigan. Then many Catholics, a lot of Catholics, a whole lot, don't feel represented by or spoken for by a handful of right-wing bishops who tell them there is only one issue on which Catholics can vote. They're saying no. All over the country. Then mainline Protestants are coming. And all the mainline denominations, well, they have felt what my neighbor would call often being dissed. Disrespected by the fundamentalists who say they're not people of faith at all. They're coming. A lot of black church folks coming out because, to be honest, this conversation about faith and politics has been a very white conversation. When the media says evangelicals, they mean white evangelicals. They don't mean the historic black churches, so they're all coming out. A lot of Latino and Asian Christians are coming out, changing all the churches everywhere they're coming to. A whole lot of rabbis are coming out. A lot of young Muslims are coming out who want a more tolerant, open, peaceful, and yes, democratic Islam. They think they're fighting for the heart of their faith. This is an internal battle within their faith. All of our great traditions have a battle going on between fundamentalism and prophetic faith in Islam, in Judaism, and Christianity. And then there's a whole lot of young people who say, "I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual." Religion, at its best, is not ideologically predictable or loyally partisan, but can critique left and right from a consistent moral ground. Now, I want to make clear, what I'm talking about here is something that I like to think about as the moral center of our public life, not the same as the political middle, which is often a very mushy place of compromise. I feel a hunger out there for that kind of bridge, that kind of faith to bring us together. When you're on a book tour, they put you on these TV shows, and some nights you're on the O'Reilly Factor, and other nights you have fun. The next night after O'Reilly was Jon Stewart Daily Show. How many of you watched Jon Stewart? So John comes back stage beforehand, and John is a funny guy, but he's a serious guy. He's a very smart guy. I knew he'd read the book because he's asking questions from the last few chapters. He says, "I'm afraid I'm going to get out there and ask silly questions." I said, "John, isn't that your job?" So he gets out there and he says, "Now, Jim, you want to bring religion, like the words of Jesus, into politics?" I can feel millions of his young audience around the country saying to themselves, "Oh no, he's got some wacko evangelical preacher on my favorite show, going to ruin my favorite show." So I said, "Yeah, John, but I don't think Jesus' two top priorities would have been a capital gains tax cut and the occupation of Iraq." So I asked, "How did Jesus become pro-rich, pro-war, and only pro-American?" It's like our faith has been stolen. When someone steals your faith in the public arena, sometimes you decide it's just time to take it back. The biggest mistake the left progressives have made in decades is conceding the entire territory of religion and values to a religious and political right. We must never make that mistake again. So the left doesn't get it because they forget the Democratic Party was tied finally to a civil rights movement led by black churches just decades ago. Where would we be if the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. kept his faith to himself? Where would we be? I believe in the separation of church and state. But that does not mean the segregation of moral values from public life or the banishing of all religious language from the public square. We can do this in a way that's democratic, open, tolerant, welcoming. We don't have to let the right control the territory nor give it up the way that we've done. I'm meeting a whole generation of young people across the country, and that's what they think. They want something big enough to command the attention of their lives. They want an agenda for their lives. So the first week I was signing books for college students. I expected that. But then they seemed younger. 15, 14. You student? Yeah. Where? High school. What year? Freshman. Mom and Dad weren't there. Just he and his friends to listen. And then younger still, 13. 12. I'm in Minneapolis. Little girl standing there to get her book signed. I look up. How old are you? I'm 11. You're 11. What did you get out of tonight? Well, I think we're just going to have to change the world. Who's going to do that? I asked her. Well, I think people like me. Every change, every single change in history over here starts with somebody over here seeing that change through the eyes of faith. And not just discussing faith. Oh, in America, we like to discuss faith. We discuss religion more than any nation on the earth. Discussing religion doesn't change things. Betting your life on faith sometimes has.
That was preacher and professor Jim Wallis. Rebecca Solnit is a cultural historian and spiritual activist. She's written several books, most recently, A Field Guide to Getting Lost. At the conference, Solnit spoke about how quickly people adjust to change and how we sometimes forget just how far we've come.
On January 18, 1915, 6 months into the First World War, as all Europe was convulsed by killing and dying, Virginia Woolf wrote in her journal, "The future is dark, which is on the whole the best thing the future can be, I think. Dark, she seems to say, as in inscrutable, not as in terrible. We often mistake the one for the other. Or we transform the future's unknowability into something certain, the fulfillment of all our dread, the place beyond which there is no way forward. But again and again, far stranger things happen than the end of the world. Who 2 decades ago could have imagined a world in which the Soviet Union had vanished and the internet had arrived? Who then dreamed that the political prisoner Nelson Mandela would become the president of a transformed South Africa? Who foresaw the resurgence of the indigenous world, of which the Zapatista uprising in southern Mexico is only the most visible phase? Who 4 decades ago could have conceived of the changed status of all who are non-white, non-male, or non-straight, the wide-open conversations about power, nature, economies, and ecologies? There are times when it seems that not only the future, but the present is dark. Few recognize what a radically transformed world we live in, one that has been transformed not only by such nightmares as global warming and global capital, but by dreams of freedom, of justice, and transformed by things we could not have dreamed of. We adjust to changes without measuring them. We forget how much the culture changed. The U.S. Supreme Court ruled in favor of gay rights on a grand scale in the summer of 2003, and in late 2004, refused to re-examine the Massachusetts State Supreme Court ruling affirming the right to same-sex marriage. Rulings inconceivable a few decades ago, even to the beneficiaries. What accretion of imperceptible, incremental changes made them possible? And how do they come about? What unknown, invisible people brought them about? And so we need to hope for the realization of our own dreams, but also to recognize a world that will remain wilder than our imaginations. It's always too soon to go home, and it's always too soon to calculate effect. I once read an anecdote by someone in Women's Strike for Peace, the first great anti-nuclear movement in the United States. the one that did contribute to a major victory, the 1963 Limited Test Ban Treaty, which brought about the end of above-ground testing of nuclear weapons and of much of the radioactive fallout that was showing up in mother's milk and baby teeth, was a woman's only movement formed partly by the woman who'd been part of the earlier movements, except that they're mostly the part that made the coffee and men off the mimeographs. And so they found this all-women's strike, and in which men were allowed just essentially to run the mimeographs and make the coffee, but never to have a speaking role. And they were enormously powerful. And WISP Women's Strike for Peace contributed to the fall of the House Un-American Activities Committee, the Homeland Security Department of its day. Positioning themselves as housewives and using humor as their weapon, they made HUAC's anti-communist interrogations ridiculous. When they were asked whether they were in cahoots with the Soviet Union, they said, well, we don't think Soviet mothers want their children irradiated either. And they really sort of subverted the whole political structure using this sort of motherly femininity in these brilliant and hilarious ways. Anyway, the woman from Women's Strike for Peace told of how foolish and futile she felt standing in the rain one morning protesting at the Kennedy White House. Years later, she heard Dr. Benjamin Spock, who'd become one of the most high-profile activists on this issue, say that the turning point for him was spotting a small group of women standing in the rain protesting at the White House. If they were so passionately committed, he thought, he should give the issue more consideration himself. And he did. Cause and effect assumes history marches forward, but history is not an army. It is a crab scuttling sideways, a drip of soft water wearing away stone, an earthquake breaking centuries of tension. Sometimes one person inspires a movement, or her words do decades later. Sometimes a few passionate people change the world. Sometimes they start a mass movement and millions do. Sometimes those millions are stirred by the same outrage or the same ideal, and change comes upon us like a change in the weather. All that these transformations have in common is that they begin in imagination, in hope. To hope is to gamble. It's to bet on the future, on your desires, on the possibility that an open heart and uncertainty are better than gloom and safety. To hope is dangerous, and yet it is the opposite of fear, for to live is to risk. Hope just means another world might be possible, not promised, not guaranteed. Hope calls for action. Action is impossible without hope. At the beginning of his massive 1930s treatise on hope, the German philosopher Ernst Bloch wrote, "The work of this emotion requires people who throw themselves actively into what is becoming, to which they themselves belong. To hope is to give yourself to the future, and that commitment to the future makes the present inhabitable. Anything could happen, and whether we act or not has everything to do with it. Though there's no lottery ticket for the lazy and the detached, for the engaged there's a tremendous gamble for the highest stakes right now. I say this to you not because I haven't noticed that the U.S. has strayed close to destroying itself and its purported values in pursuit of empire in the world and the eradication of democracy at home, that our civilization is close to destroying the very nature on which we depend, the oceans, the atmosphere, the uncounted species of plant and insect and bird. I say it because I have noticed wars will break out, the planet will heat up, species will die out, but how many, how hot, and what survives depends on whether we act. The future is dark, with a darkness as much of the womb as of the grave."
That was author and spiritual activist Rebecca Solnit speaking in Berkeley, California. That's it for this edition of Making Contact. Special thanks to the Tikkun community. Our theme music is by the Charlie Hunter Trio. Making Contact is an independent production funded primarily by generous gifts from people in the community. We are committed to providing a unique forum for voices and opinions not often heard in the mass media. For a cassette or CD copy of program number 4605, call the National Radio Project at 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also visit our website at radioproject.org. Lisa Redman is our executive director, Justin Beck, associate producer, Dorian Taylor, communications manager, Esther Mania, outreach coordinator, Tom Evans, Development Associate, Emily Polk, Production Fellow,